For it to stay and remain. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be unto your holy name.
Amen.
Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Let's be seated gloriously in the presence of the Most High God. I want to thank the church for the opportunity this morning. I want to thank our Father and the Lord, our pastor, the set man. I like that word. For the opportunity to give us this morning to minister to us. Praise God. The topic before us this morning says, a generation chosen to impact change. A generation that is chosen to impact change. Praise God. You know, when I was really coining this topic, I think Pastor just pretty much watered upon it last Sunday with a particular verse, and I eventually had to use that verse as my major verse. Praise God. A lot of things he has said, Michael, he has preached from the Sunday school class when we were there. He was saying everything I was supposed to be saying. When he came on stage now, he has been saying everything that I need to be saying. Praise God. But we're going to reiterate it. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9. It's a verse that we all know very well. Pastor mentioned this verse last Sunday. For those of us that I remember, look at what this verse says. He says, but ye are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are an holy nation. You are a peculiar people. When God begins to describe you and they begin to give you all kinds of characteristics and it has not ended, you continue to have a lot of comma, a peculiar people. After that, you know what God told us? He said that you should show forth the praises of Him who has called you. Who has called you? Chosen, selected. For a particular purpose, who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Chosen, selected, out of many, you were selected. We are talking about a generation that has been chosen. Praise God. Whether we like it or not, the generation now is the generation that has been chosen by God Himself. I don't know about you. I'm not just talking about the youth. I'm talking about as long as you are within this generation now, you are part of the generation. The generation now are the ones we are talking about. They have been chosen to impact change. You cannot live within this generation and live just like that. You must be ready. It must be a vision upon you to decide to yourself. I must be among them. That will impact change. Not just in this church, not just in your local environment, not just in your home, not just in your family, not at your workplace alone, but globally. The Bible has said that we should go ye forth out into the world. Globally. There's a lot that I tell people sometimes. I said, if God show you a vision right now, where you are supposed to be, we are just trying, right? We are just trying to be where you need to be. But I tell people that if God should show you a vision, 1080p, 4K, vision of where you need to be. I tell people that you begin to cry. Because the change that you are supposed to be impacting, you have not started. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
We have to acknowledge the fact that we are chosen. We are unique. We are special. You are encrafted by God and the divine manufacturer himself for a purpose. Now let me let you know that once you begin to realize that, many of us are sitting there, we are looking majestically this morning, but have we realized why you are chosen? Do you know why you have been chosen? The Bible says in that first Peter 2:9, it says, but ye are a chosen. You are a chosen. There's a reason why you have been selected. Until you understand why you have been chosen, It is very difficult to impact change. I will repeat that. Until you have understood why you have been chosen, it will be very difficult to impact change. When he completed your design, he understood and believed that beyond every reasonable doubt, you can become the best talent that you can be, that he has given unto you. Beyond every reasonable doubt, God believed it. Before you were born, he knew what you were going to do. David, before he defeated Goliath, 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 14. Let's look at that real quick. I have something to bring out of that by the time before I break out. 1 Samuel. The Bible says in that verse 14, and David was the youngest, and the three elders followed Saul. The Bible, there was a reason why the Bible was telling us why he was the youngest. That even at his own certain age, there are a lot of things he can do. By the special grace of God, you saw what the youth did this morning. The time is coming when the youth minister, you will not stereotype them as youths. I don't know if you understood that. The time is coming when the youth will minister. We will just be coming to church for service. That is all we are going to say. Yes, there's a reason why we're calling the youth on it, because we find out that it's a certain age, they are coming, they are ministering unto us. But I'm telling you this, mark my words this morning, that there's a time that the youth will minister. We will not need to be saying that they are youths anymore. Because the blind will begin to see. The lame will begin to walk. Those that are downcasted will begin to raise up. In the name of Jesus. David was the youngest. And I don't know if you remember, by the time when they had come together, and I think that's in verse. When the elders brought out, he now came to him and he was trying to shut him down. What are you talking about? Go back and till the sheep. What do you know about this Goliath that we are talking about? What is your own business there? Do we see that sometimes in the church today? What do we tell the younger ones? Go and sit down. But look at who God decided to use out of all the elderly ones and the adults. God had already preordained what David was going to do. One instruction this morning. In the life of all your youth, parents, the Bible says that as arrows are in the hands of a mighty one, so are the children of our youth. When you look at your youth today, tell them God bless you. Because God has a purpose for them in the church. And that's why I like what is going on today. I like the fact that they are being put together, integrated into the service this morning to begin to show their relevance in the church. Let me tell you, the youth are very relevant. The topic says that a generation has been chosen to impact change. I have split it this morning. We are talking about the reason why we are important, why we have been chosen, why we have been selected, why we are unique, we are special. Not just the children, you to the adults. You are all special for a reason. That's the first part of it. You have now been chosen to impact change in this generation. That's going to be the second part. Every youth in the house, understand this. When I mention the word youth, I've not tagged any specific age on any youth. I've not said, look, if you're 25, are you a youth or not? I've not tagged nothing on it. If you're 40, are you a youth? I'm not tagging age on it. Look, as far as I'm concerned, the word youth means that you have not got to the evening of your life. Can somebody say amen to that? Yeah. The word youth, it means that you have not arrived at the evening of your life. There's still a lot that God has in store for you to do. They are saying the youths are doing it. Look, whatever age you are, you can jump up and you can be popping for the Lord. Because there's going to come a time that you'll be so old that you have to get people to get you, help you sit down and all of that. But if that time has not come yet, then it is left for you to understand that you yourself, you can impact change even as you are. Praise God. So parents, are we going to allow our youth to fly? Are we going to allow our youth to do what they need to do in the house of God? Are we ready to allow our youth to begin to have as a generation come with a different dimension? Come with a different kind of change in church? Because that is a key. That is a special formula that we needed today. Our youth are the ones that are going to do it. Enough of having our parents keeping the youth at home, or when they tell them to come for something, you are. Do you know how many youths here, when we call for something in the church, it's difficult for them to come? But when it's time for a special football practice, or basketball practice, or soccer practice, we are ready to take them. We will drive them down there, we will bring them back, no problem. But when it's time for things in the church, we have issue with it. We have to say enough of that. It is time to start getting your youth to understand that the reason why they're in church is for a particular purpose, is to grow them spiritually. That they will be able to take over the next generation. Generation now, it is your time to shine. Generation now, it is your time to shine. To impact change, what is change? What is change? Change is to make or become different. I hope, first of all, we have already understood why we are a chosen generation. A peculiar people, a royal priesthood. I hope you have understood that. I'm going somewhere. I have my time, and I have it calculated as to how I'm going to get on with this. Praise God. So what is change? Change is to make or become different. You are moving from one particular position onto another. You cannot stay on the same spot. The moment you begin to remain on the same spot, it tells me that you are not ready to change. Now, change can be positive and change can be negative. Do we believe that? Change can be positive and change can be negative. Do you know that these big companies, Apple, Microsoft, HP, name them. There's a reason why when they release products in the market, there's a reason why they have to always change them. Apps, WhatsApp, Facebook app, all these products, these technology products that we use, there's a reason why they always have to bring out new ones. Can you imagine if Apple company today, this coming year in October, I know I'm in technology a lot, so I know. This coming October, they're going to be releasing the next iPhone. Those of us that know about when they release their products. Can you imagine if by October, no announcement is made, they just decide to keep quiet, they don't decide to do anything about any new release. What do you think is going to happen to Apple? Those of us that know. First of all, their stock market is going to do what? What is going to happen to the consumers? What are they going to say? What's up? In fact, you begin to hear all kind of negative criticism about why they are doing what they are doing. They have become, after they've been releasing every year, they've been releasing new one. This year now, they decide to just keep quiet. They decide to stop. No new release. Samsung, they just released a new version 9 of their phone. Can you imagine if they didn't release it? Change. They have to always do something different. Continue to do something different. New. Change. Different, so that it can continue to attract people. Change is about what you do different to attract people. The world today is a very fast-paced environment. Technology is moving faster than ever before. And do you know what's happening? TV, internet, media, social media, things are moving very fast. And do you know what's happening? The people in the world continue to see that, and guess what? they are attracted to it. They have implemented change in a way that people are attracted to it. You have mentioned change several times in the church. Are we, let me give you one of my points that I mentioned here. I said, this is what I said here. I said you can be chosen, but you may not impact change. Can somebody say amen to that?
Amen.
You can be chosen by God, but you may not impact change. This is another point I put down. I said change can be impacted, but it might not be effective. I hope the thing is going in one year and stay. I said change can be impacted, but it might not be effective. Apple can release the next iPhone. If that iPhone has a default, has a defect, it has become ineffective. It is not effective. Change can happen. Change is happening all the time. But is the change effective? Is the change effective? Now, listen to this. If you are not part of God's elect, if you are not selected by God, I told you that there's two types of change, positive and negative. If you are not a part of God's elect, you either remain on the same spot, you either go backwards, or you become an agent of negative change. How about that? In this church, it's time for us to begin to realize that we need change. We need to step out of our comfort zone. I believe I need to start getting on to why we need to impact change, ways that we're going to use to impact change. Because our generation is a chosen generation.
Amen.
We are chosen for a purpose.
Amen.
And it is time to begin to impact change.
Amen.
The Bible says in that 2 Corinthians 3:18 about how we must move from one level of glory to the other. You cannot stay on the same spot. Let me tell you that some people, they have been on the same spot. In this church, there are some people that sit on a particular point, on a particular seat all the time. I'm not going to mention names now. But we are not moving. So on certain days, we don't have to be so religious. Guys, use the word guys. That you used to use now, and they will condemn us against producing guys. Recently, I've heard some children call their parents guys now. They are quite used to it. They are not even, they forget it. That's what they are. That's the word. It's not change. Guys. When are we going to stop being so religious in the church? That is when we begin to realize that we're changing gradually to accept the world. To accept. Do you know that? Something in me keeps telling me that there might be a reason why the population in this church is not going past this. That those back rows are always still empty. Now I'll tell you this, how long have we been in this particular location? I think about 10 years plus there about. And we have prayed concerning this neighborhood. True or false? In fact, last Thursday again, I was just smiling because it was in my notes. When I think it was Maria came and he said, let's raise our hands to the neighborhood and pray again for the neighborhood, my God. And we have been praying for the neighborhood. Who does not know we have not been praying for the neighborhood? And Pastor can pray. Let me tell you, Pastor has prayed. Pastor has prayed. Where we don't know, Pastor has prayed. So I tell myself this. God is not deaf that he cannot hear the prayer. Think God, I just a side note about Nigeria, for example. God has answered prayer of Nigeria, right? But the hands of the people are the ones making sure Nigeria doesn't go forward. Just a side note. But we have prayed. We pray. Is there no a revival coming up again and we call it 12 hours? We are coming to pray again. We are praying. But there's an issue. There's an issue on ground that we are not realizing. We are not seeing it. We are not seeing something. There's something we are missing. What are we missing? I said we have been here for so long and we are praying about this neighborhood. What is it that we are missing? Do you know that it's when a church is being born and they start and they commence, whichever lifestyle that the church uses every day is what they use. And I'm sorry, I don't want to stereotype this morning, but I must. And so this is what, sorry, forgive again. This is what I was going to say. That maybe, who knows, that the population of Nigerians, I'm sorry to use the word Nigerians. Sir, I was telling someone this last Sunday, that the population of Nigerians in this church right now, maybe God has said, let's cap the Nigerians, enough of Nigerians. The rest of the seats are empty, are meant for, as the Bible says, go ye forth out into the world and do what? Preach gospel unto who? All nations. So where are our Asians? Maybe God is not telling us, okay? Because we are in America, we are not in Japan. In a Japanese church in Japan, they are Japanese. You are in America, a nation of diverse people. So there is no way that you can be in America. That's why a lot of choir saying, we are Nigerian, what can we sing? Like, you know, let me tell you, you are in America. You are in America. You are not in China. You must sing Chinese somewhere in China. Trust me. Because when you go to the mall, they are going to speak Chinese to you. But when you're in America, America speaks what? That is the word we use here. So who knows? And I'm just saying, maybe that the rest of the seats are meant for other nations, tribes, tongues, and people. That we need to cap the percentage of Nigerians, that should be it. That we have had enough of us anyway. Because guess what? Nigerians are a special set of people. We are special.
Yes.
And as special as we are, we have, I'm sorry to say, we have what I call, we I don't know how to use the word, whether we criticize. No, I don't want to But I want to be real with us this morning. Praise God. I want to be real with us this morning. The kind of change we're looking for that God is expecting. I've said it already. There's a reason why God has answered the prayer. The Bible says that when Paul plants, Apollo will water, and the increase will come from God. Let me tell us something about this church today. God has given us increase. Do you know the problem?
No.
Paul has not planted. And Apollo has not watered in this church. I lost us. Oh my God. The Bible says that when Paul will plant and Apollo will water, that's when the increase will come. Now, like I told you, our pastor is a man of prayer. We are prayed. God has given us increase. There's a secret to us making this church different. We need to come out from the status quo. From how we see ourselves. How we see. Look, when God says to go out into the world and preach the gospel, that means that people that are going to come in here, what if someone comes in here with all kinds of tattoos on his body? Do you know when you go out there, you're not going to see someone like me suited up with a nice haircut, nice shoe? Because do you know that when we come to church, that is what we see, especially in our Nigerian setting. Those are the kind of people we're always looking for. But guess what? We need to start changing that. What are we doing to adapt what is out there to bring it in here for the church? How many of us know what's going on in Houston today? What is the biggest event going on right now in Houston? Houston Rodeo! When we step out here, some of us are actually thinking of going to Rodeo today. But I don't even know. But this is the thing. Are we trying to adapt what the world is giving to the world that is attracting them? Operation BAM, that's what I call it. B-A-M-N, by any means necessary. When the devil wants to bring the world to himself, he goes by what? By any means necessary. He will attract them to the world. TV, radio, media, attraction, whatever it takes, the devil is doing. And guess what? He does it gradually and suddenly. And gradually you're leaving the church because you like what is out there. You continue to leave the church because guess what? Especially the youth, they like it. That is what is attracting them. What can Isaac generation begin to do to begin to attract and attract. When you see Roger come up like this, Isaac Generation should not shut his faith out of it. Isaac Generation should look for something to do to make sure that the youth will come in. Super Bowl just finished. I don't know how many people are part of it. NBA, what? I'm a fan of basketball. I like using rockets. When the playoff comes up, how do we know about it? Look, let me, that is how I said, so if God is, if we need to attract the church as well, what do we need to do? By any means necessary. Bring them in. When they begin to have their tattoos and their dressing anyhow, by the time God begins to minister to them, they'll begin to realize that this is not the way I should look. I like what Pastor said in his Sunday school this morning in our class. He said, come in your Sunday best. He showed, he mentioned one of them that was not dressing too good. I like good dressing. But also, we also need to realize that when all these people come in, they don't expect you to be telling them how to dress up. Let me tell you, that is what change is all about. Attract them in first. Let them be looking like however they're looking. I don't care how they're looking, because that is the world for you. The world includes gays, lesbians, people with tattoos, people with nose piercing. And when they come in, let them come in first. Let them come in. Accept them for who they are. When you accept them, God will begin to do his work upon them. God will begin to do his perfect work upon them. Now, brother, that is what I call change. I like where we are today. I like where we've started. Look at time. Look at how we have turned around time. Thank God for Pastor. Because I remember 2 Sundays ago, I think about, we went to the office there, we prayed about, after service we prayed. And so he said that it was upon his heart that year over year, these people are coming to us and telling us about time, that we need to do something about it, such and such. And I like how, even on the Thanksgiving Day, look at the time, in America, it's all about time, and I thank God that we have been able to see that. Change. That is change. We have decided to change from that. Positive change. Positive change. Change that will take us to the next level. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
That's it. We must change from being local champions to world champions. We are local. Brethren, we are local. We are too local. On Sunday, you know what, for some reason, I didn't like the fact that we were coming in what we are coming in today. You know why? I didn't like the fact that we are all coming in gyms today and everything we are coming in. Because I wanted to talk about the fact that when we come every Sunday, we are always, I don't even know how the day that Pastor didn't come in time. How many of us remember that? There was something wrong with me. I was surprised. I had to be shaking my head. Pastor, no time. Pastor, no time. Pastor, did not wear time. Are we safe? But I like what the Lord has been saying today. Even today, he was talking about a workers' meeting. Those of you that heard him. He said, if I come this Sunday and next Sunday, if I come dressed like this, look, we need to stop being. Sorry, we should be more stuck up. We need to stop being too religious and stuck up in how we behave in church. When you look at your neighbor, there's no Operation NYOB. That like, you know what that means? Operation mind your own business. When you begin to focus on God, when you begin to implement Operation NYOB, the change that you require, that you needed to take up to the next level, you yourself as an individual, you needed to begin to apply that. When you begin to mind your own business with God, you are focused on God alone. Don't worry about what your neighbor is wearing. Don't worry about what they're looking like. Don't worry about how they smell. Let me leave that to God. Let God correct that upon them. What the new generation is about. Operation Bell and Operation BY, MY, OB. Let God do the correction. Let us change from being local champions to world champions. Now, we are local champions in this realm now, and this is the reason. We cannot attract anybody else. All the people you have been seeing here, look, about 99.1% are Nigerians in this church. And we're in America. This is the kind of setting you should see in Nigeria. This generation, the way we are now, our demography of race, this is the kind of setting you see in Nigeria. We are thank God for a couple of his friends that's in the house, just the lingo. Wait, stop. But this is it. This is the kind, this is local. In Nigeria, this is the kind of church you see. But we are in America. And there's a reason why we're here. We're here to attract not just the Nigerians. We're supposed to be attracting every other race, tribe, tongue, and people. And how do you do that? That's how you become world champions. Right now, we're only local champions and we continue to sing Bami Rabata. We continue to Rabata all the time in church. The more you do that, I tell myself this. Look, I tell my friends this. I tell my co-workers this. You continue to act this particular way. You continue to do it in this certain way. The only people you're going to attract is who?
Rabata.
That is it. And I'm telling you this, we are praying. This is a secret weapon I'm giving unto us this morning as a church. I'm coming as they say, the oracle of God this morning to give us this insight, this secret weapon about why we are praying. Are we going to continue to pray about this neighborhood? You continue to pray and look, and like I said, God has answered us. Paul and Apollo are not watching and planting nothing. That's the problem. Paul and Apollo, we are not doing what we need to do to attract outside. And that's why, again, I thank Pastor for what he's doing in getting the youth to be relevant in the church. It's going to start from things like that. Praise God. Our pastor might be from Nigeria. Does not mean that our church should be Nigeria. Our pastor might be Nigerian. Does not mean that our church should be That is why we are not attracting the world. That is why we are local champions, because we continue to only see Nigerians. I like the Asian community. For some weird reason, I just like the Asian community. I don't know. But I would like a church whereby it's not just Nigerians I see here, United Generation. Then I want the time to come where I'll see Asian, Latino, the Hispanic, Indian, Koreans, and everybody. That is what I want to see. When Pastor come on the stage, even two pastors will begin to have to be changing the song. Let someone shout hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. That's what we need to begin to change. Our chairman has said it before. He has talked about how we need to begin to change our tongue somehow to attract the world. Hello?
Hello. Change our tongue.
The youth are the ones that are going to help us begin with this change.
Amen.
What to do.
Amen.
Praise God. From the service, from the praise worship, to how, look, there are churches today, when a member comes to the church, you know what? You don't need to tell them to come back next Sunday. They will come back because of what they see in the service. From the way the choir will sing, and that is why, by the grace of God, let God help us with some certain investments. Because what attracts? Look, I don't know if you've seen TV, how everything is shining, glaring, everything. That is what attracts the world. There was a time that I was about to implement this lighting. Do you know that some people in the church are saying, they're bringing clubhouse to the church. They're bringing party hall. There is going to be a party hall. They're bringing, and they didn't like it. People are mentioning that. Did you know that even the lighting, when we started this lighting of a thing, Pastor didn't even want these white fluorescents to come on. Because there's a certain mood that you set. Pastor didn't even like, ever since that, they've been trying on and they were telling us because of effect, something. Pastor didn't want these ones to be on. And yes, I don't like it to be on. You know why? I don't know if any of you have been to Lakewood or have been to the way there's a certain mood of worship. Man, when you're there, it's like, wow. The lighting, that's why I pray by the special grace of God, let us begin to have investments in the way our choir will look the stage, the instrumentalist, professionally. By the time we say, is there any first timers in the house, the people that will raise their hands will no longer be Nigerians. And after that, they will not need to beg them to come next Sunday. In fact, there's a church I know, they give them second timers gift. Just because they come next Sunday. Second timers gift is what they give them. Investing in such things in a church will attract outsiders. That is what we're talking about. I have 2 pages of thoughts. I didn't know I'm going to be running like this. I only have 3 minutes left. Praise God. So I said ways to impact change. Number one was we must change from local champions to become world champions. Number two, I have by utilizing God's given talents of our youth. What you saw this morning, I don't know how many was in the life of the praise worship, but it was super. I thank God for the hashtag that we used last Sunday and this Sunday. I was kind of embarrassed that, you know, I had to come up to be explaining to the church how to use hashtag. So I didn't need to be doing that. We're already a world champion church. Pastor just needs to come on stage. Praise God. Pastor GNA, our chairman, I celebrate you. Hashtag FOL Houston 2018. Praise God. Let's start with service. That's what I want. I don't want that I have talents to start coming and be explaining to us which one to touch, which one to praise. When we have become a world champion church, we will go from levels to levels.
Amen.
We'll be flying. We'll be flying in this church. And that time is coming. That time is coming. Enough for us being a Nigerian church. I don't know how many of us are with me. Enough of that. And number three, I have by utilizing technology, you know, and all these bells and whistles. I don't know how many of us know. I know Pastor Leslie knows, but my time is wrong. I don't bring cash anymore to church. And Pastor always sees my notification when I do my payments. And I know only a couple of people. When Pastor will come out here and say, tithe, let's give our tithe. And he knows those people. He said, those of you that pay online. I'm so used to technology that if I see cash in my hand, maybe because my wife gave it to me. But I'm so used to using card and online services. So I pay everything online. I'm not saying now that you be telling Pastor you are paid now, you're not paying nothing online. But my whole point is just the fact that I'm running with technology. I'm not leaving it behind. There are a lot of things that we don't know about technology. We need to start getting to that level. And the youth know about this. The youth know about the technology that's being used. That's what we need to begin to bring them into the church. That's what we need to begin to make them relevant in the church so that they can begin to attract people that are not just the way we look. So, I think we have now realized why I was talking about being a chosen generation and impacting change. Are we ready to impact change? I'm going to rise up on your feet. Father, because I am a chosen generation, give me the grace to be able to impact change in my time. Talk to God. Talk to God. Father, because I am a... Look, I'm not just chosen to be a mere person. God divinely orchestrated me that I'll be able to impact change in my own time. I don't care how old I look, what I look like. None of us are old in this place. You can impact change. Give me the grace to be able to impact change in my own time. In the name of Jesus. Pray. Elevate me from a level of a local champion to a world champion. Elevate me from a level of a local champion to... Let us begin to think outside the box. We have been thinking inside the box for too long. That is why we cannot impact the neighborhood. That is why we cannot impact anybody else. Give us the grace to begin to move from local champions to world champions. In the name of Jesus. And finally, your last prayer is this. Father, help the youth to begin to facilitate change in this generation. Help the youth to begin to facilitate change in this generation. In the mighty name of Jesus. Go ahead and pray that prayer. Go ahead and pray that prayer.
Let's pray. Let's lift up our voices and talk to God. We are asked to pray for our children, our youth.